Starfleet Underground. Every week, we'll take a look at the latest Star Trek news and then check out a current or classic episode of Star Trek. Hang on to your hats because things are about to get weird. Scientifically speaking, Georgiou gets some medical attention. Saru gets a new catchphrase. Tilly becomes particular about how you address the captain. Book's brother is affecting our first officer. Linus is shedding. And Osira is Space Karen.
Right. Fresh coffee. Somebody put in the program to replicate Krispy Kreme donuts. This is a good morning. Now I just got to wait for the show to... Oh, wait. The light is already on.
We're already on, sir.
Sorry about that. Good morning, good afternoon, and good day, everybody. Thank you for joining us for another wonderful episode for Starfleet Underground. We are the show that's brought to you by Section 31. Apparently, they're a little upset that I don't mention them enough. We are the podcast where we're always cloaked. So there's that. I'm your captain here on this vessel. My name is Captain Nathan Adams, and we have our entire crew. However, we haven't made it back to the Delta Quadrant to get a guest yet. News went out about the old ship, how we kept doing transporter accidents with them. So I think confidence is not extremely high, so we're going to have to change that. We have our science officer. Good morning.
Hi, good morning. I'm Heather Ferris. I'm the science officer. And I replicated this skin tight white outfit, and I'm trying to put it on the Tribbles, and they are just not having it. They are like running away from me, Captain, and I think I need you to come down here and help me.
To put it on there?
Well, who wants hairy sperm? I mean, you know, they would look like hairy sperm.
Okay, so what's wrong with that?
Hello? You ever tried to swallow hairy sperm?
Oh!
No, but you have? What was that like?
She has standards, sir.
That's not what I heard.
Oh!
We're already starting on a different foot this morning, and I don't think the Tribbles
started it with the sperm.
I always start it.
And I don't think the Tribbles particularly like it, because it's the first time. Usually they have two settings. Either they do the sweet little trill, or they do the scream. This is the first time I heard them coming out of your room grumbling.
I thought they were moaning.
Grumbling.
They usually grumble when I put on those like little sweaters and everything on them. They hate it. You know, I think it's like the sweater against the fur. It doesn't feel good. But I mean, it's cold in here. I got to put a sweater on.
They're already wearing a fur coat.
They need another sweater. Besides, I got cute sweaters over here.
Oh my goodness. What?
If you were a Tribble, would you want someone putting a sweater on you?
If I was a Tribble, there's a lot of things I would want people to do that they wouldn't do.
La, 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 la.
Don't mess with the redheaded Tribble.
I was thinking, feed me, feed me.
Sure you were.
And the other word with the F in it.
Feed me into what?
That's why we have to be on a tight beam, because Heather is a Tribble.
Yeah, which reminds me, did HR get a hold of you, our computer person, Patrick?
I'm Patrick. I'm the computer guy. I'm number one. I'm also the foreign... What am I? The foreign?
Get laid, son. The foreign get laid, son.
No.
Getting laid on?
The foreign species liaison.
Oh, okay. Yeah. The reason why I'm asking you is because last week's episode, and please do not replicate the sound now. Apparently, HR, even though they don't listen to us when we broadcast, one of the members listens to the show after the fact. And your sound effect of sucking got them interested in contacting you for a date.
Yeah, no.
They said they was going to try to get a hold to you.
Nope, not interested.
Yeah, I think that they were, though, so they might be contacting you later.
Somebody's got a fan.
Yeah, a big fan.
I just won't be answering any subspace communications then.
No, from what I heard, when they heard the sound, HR person laughed on moisture and then tried to get a hold of you. So there is that.
Ew.
And we We have, of course, our really, it goes without saying, are the best engineer in the quadrant here in Rocky.
I've got all the Christmas lights ready to go up on the ship. I just need some time to put them up.
Nice.
I'm so excited.
Are you putting them on the outside again this year?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We want to blink.
Because it confuses the hell out of the people who do IFF visual.
Well, you got to have them bright. You got, if they're not bright enough, what's the point?
As long as you don't put those big floaty characters in the hallway again, you can barely get past them. And there's so many people in there and you're just trying to push your way through.
I must admit, the Frosty the Snowman is rather large.
It's that nose of his.
Yeah, and don't put mistletoe everywhere. The tribbles know what that is. And no matter where I walk, if I cross under, they start molesting my feet. So,
ankle kissers.
Yeah. So, true, let's not do that part with the mistletoe.
All right, no mistletoe.
Okay. And despite what Patrick begs you to do, do not put them in the bathroom over the urinals.
No, and we could do without a life-size gingerbread house this year.
But there's plenty of room in the cargo bay.
But where are we going to bake the little children?
No, the gingerbread house was actually kind of neat because if you went in and you got hungry,
you just start eating the walls.
I can't stop eating.
You can eat the children that we baked.
I'm gaining 100 pounds because of this. Rocky, stop it.
Okay.
It was pretty good. Now, since you're getting ready to go on a date with HR, I know you are.
No.
You're going to take one for the team. Was there any corrections?
I do not believe. Let me make sure. I don't believe I saw any subspace communications come across. Nope. Nothing that I'm aware of.
Okay. Are you sure?
No one messaged us.
Are you totally sure? Are you hinting at something, Captain?
No. I just wanted to tease him a little bit because HR is into him. I think it's funny.
No, as far as I know.
They gave me a wink. HR, they said, stands for you. It stands for hard rearing. So we're going to see what's going on with that. Oh, my God. I told you. Now they're really going to come on to you.
He's such a tease.
Now we're going to talk about news of the week. You got any news, Heather?
Hi, Captain. So my news this week is there is going to be a Star Trek Voyager documentary.
Ooh.
Production of this has resumed, and it will be different from the Deep Space Nine documentary. This documentary will include HD footage. However, there is no estimate as to when it's going to be released.
Oh, that sounds like it's going to be pretty cool. And how about you there, Pat? You got any news?
Yeah, so GalaxyCon Live is doing several Star Trek virtual events in January and December. December 5th, we have William Shatner, Kate Mulgrew, and some TOS guests, which would be Bobby Clark, who played the Gorn, Sean Kenny, who played Christopher Pike and Lieutenant T'Pol, Nathan Jung, which was Genghis Khan, Mariette Hartley, which was Zara Beth, and Francis Nguyen, which was Ilana of Troyes. And then, ooh, this one you want, December 12th, Nichelle Nichols, all by herself. And then January 3rd, we've got Star Trek DS9 stars, which will be Terry Farrell, Armin Shimerman, Nana Visitor, Andrew Robinson. And they're doing a free live Q&A. And then...
Wait, you said free?
Free, yes. Free live Q&A. Yes. And then we got on December 6th, Cirroc Lofton is going to be at HoloCon. It's the Lambda Quadrant podcast. Then December 8th, John DeLancey with the Star Trek cruise. There's a live chat with John DeLancey. And that is my news.
They're still doing the cruise coming up. Well, thankfully, some Section 31 people made it to Earth. And like we warned a couple of shows ago, people didn't believe us that they were sneaking around the temporal directive and helping them come up with a vaccine. So it looks like there was more than one Section 31 out there because now they're having a contest on which one could help Earth develop it first. So it's going to be interesting on that. But in the conventions, we'll be back. Yay. Rocky?
Yes.
Do you have any news?
News. Oh, the news this week. You know, my reliable favorite, trickmovie.com. Looks like they got this actually from Deadline. Deadline was doing some work on the Noah Hawley Star Trek film project. But we find out that they put it on the shelf. Paramount has shelved the project. So I don't know what's going on. There's lots of little details, lots of people to talk to. I mean, they even mentioned Tarantino's project, too. So it's a lot of question marks going on. I think, honestly, between you and me, guys, I mean, COVID screwed everybody up. And Paramount was doing this huge transition, buying Viacom back and getting back together with them. So I think they're just shuffling stuff still, trying to figure out exactly what they're doing. Not in a bad way, not to say they don't know what they're doing. They're just trying to figure out what they're doing.
Cool.
It really, a lot of companies now are dealing with this COVID thing. They found that the side effect from this COVID is that rent is going down on places that used to have really high rent, because now with people being able to work from home, they don't have to live near the job anymore. So they could be far off where rent is cheaper. And it's also forcing companies to reassess what they're going to do with real estate, with office space and everything else. Because before all this time, they kept yelling, we can't have people work from home. We can't have people work from home. Now that they are, and work is getting done and hasn't been slacking, it goes, well, maybe we can get people to work from home now. So it's definitely changed. Even when the vaccine hits, it's going to really change fundamentally how a lot of business is being done. And for news, this is not Star Trek related, but it is news. There was a bunch of really good movies was slated to hit the theater coming up this Christmas. Well, Warner Brothers has teamed up with HBO to decide to not only let the movies out in the theaters, but if you have HBO Max, it's going to be simultaneously released for that word that the Ferengis hate, free, the same day. First one is going to be Wonder Woman 1984. That's going to be in the theater as well as on HBO Max. They're hoping that all these big hits that they're going to have on HBO Max will get people to strive over and join their streaming service. And we all know that streaming service is really cutthroat right now.
It's the only game in town, honestly. It's I mean, depending on what part of the country you're in and what your attitude is, theaters might be off limits for the next, you know, year. I mean, maybe 6 months, maybe. I mean, until everybody gets their vaccine and starts feeling comfortable about being in public with other people, some people aren't going to be going out to theaters. It's just the fact of life. But we got to be entertained still.
We've got all those anti-vaxxers, too. So they're not going to want to get a vaccination.
Well, yeah.
So.
And they're going to probably suffer once they do that. And we can talk about Darwinism. But I, you know, not that I have any opinion on this whatsoever.
However,
some people want to stay at home and watch in their home theater. And we've been talking about doing this for a long time because we have lots of nice home movie theaters in our home theater systems. But in our screens are beautiful and big. And why not? We just want to watch the movies. We'll pay for them. We don't have to go there in public. Yeah, somebody might be making an arm and a leg on our popcorn charges, but we still need to see movies.
Yeah, popcorn, definitely.
Oh, speaking of, I think Mulan is now available generally on Disney Plus. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. It was December 2nd, I believe, it became free to watch on Disney Plus.
Oh, wait. When you say free on Disney Plus, so you have to pay for Disney Plus. It's not like free.
No.
Oh, yeah.
No, okay. Disney Plus is cheap.
No, yeah. It's free is once you get into the service, you're not paying anything more for it. Sometimes you pay for a service and you're paying more. But no, with Disney, you pay for it. And if it's on the system, you get it.
So if I wanted to watch Mulan, how much would I have to give Disney?
I think it's like $11.99.
Yeah.
I went for the full year, so out $70 or whatever it was. But it's been worth it because of Mandalorian and other great stuff that's on there.
I did it when it was first coming out. I did a 3-year deal. So.
Oh, you went the full 3. Wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
I think it was bungled in with something else I got, which means I didn't have to pay for it until, I guess, this month.
Yeah, deals are out there to be had. You just have to go find them.
And the thing with Disney Plus, not to pimp it, but Disney Plus, if you get it, you have access to the entire Disney catalog of all their movies, shows, all the things that Pixar did, all the Marvel movies, just about all the Star Wars and all of National Geographic.
And I'm just dripping into the documentaries too, and not to mention I'm still catching up on all the Star Wars animation, those shows.
If you're dripping, you might want to see the Hollow Doctor.
Oh, you sure? Yeah, but or get a towel,
right?
You just dab it off with the white covered Tribble.
There you go. It'll blend right in.
The spermy Tribble.
And Heather, do you have any news?
I already did the news.
Oh my God, I really need that coffee.
Hello, crackhead.
See, I could tell whenever I say something that's wrong because Heather gets really quiet before she corrects me. So I know.
That's the sound of her biting her tongue for a second and then not saying what she was thinking.
Instead of saying, you fucking moron, I already did the news. Wake the fuck up.
See, a part of my brain said she did. And the other part was like, are you sure? Are you really, really sure? So that's why I asked. Well, now that we get the news and everything on the way. Wait, Heather, did you do the recap already? That was a joke. Let's go ahead and continue. Let's start off. Heather, you're on.
Sure, no problem.
He's got jokes. He thinks he's funny. He's got jokes.
Mm-hmm. I made a funny. Ha, 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 ha. I love that part in the movie. Nothing to do with Star Trek, by the way. Okay, going on to Star Trek. Star Trek Discovery, Season 3, Episode 8, Sanctuary. This first aired on Thursday, December 3rd, 2020, and it was directed by Jonathan Frakes. The writers for this episode was Brandon Schultz and Kenneth Lynn, who also wrote the short trek, The Girl Who Made the Stars. So the teaser, a message. Giorgio gets a checkup from the doctor and finds out that future possible symptoms include having trouble remembering where the bodies are buried. Book needs to go home due to some family issues. Discovery will thankfully give him a lift, but they have to get permission from the Admiral first. And nephew Toller is transworm meat because Auntie Osira wasn't pleased with how things were handled two episodes ago.
So this was Giorgio again in top form. I mean, just the snappy comebacks and the way, like when she said Culber's, diagnosing her and she's like, well, if I had time to poison your children, he's like, well, if I had time, I'd have children. Meh.
Yeah,
he's not intimidated.
There were great quotes from that section. Like there were several great quotes, including the very, very first quote when we open up the scene where I'm from. The Emperor's personal physicians were buried with them when they died and it incentivized loyalty.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can tell Culber is not intimidated by Giorgio at all. He's just like, no, bitch, please sit down. He's like, I've died. I've come back. You ain't got nothing on me. So
yeah, Culber is one of those kinds of doctors that have dealt with difficult patients before. I think that's the reason why he can deal with Stamets so often, is because he's dealt with difficult patients. If you've ever seen anybody in a hospital and see how stubborn they get about things, it's amazing.
Well, I think speaking on that, people being in the hospital and being stubborn, that has to do with them being terrified. And
it's not a fucking picnic, that's for sure.
Yeah, Giorgio is terrified. She is lashing out because that's what you do when you're terrified and you don't know what else to do, is you make other people feel bad. And she's like, I could deconstruct you both with a snappy insult and a withering glance. I mean, hello.
She's very good at that too.
Yes, but she's terrified.
But the thing is that I like about her is that this first section detailed the acting chops for both of them. First is because he's developed a way that he seems to be still kind and polite and his wit, but yet you detect a note of he in his way is just as dangerous as Giorgio. He's doing it. He's not backing down. He's not fearful. He's showing a lot of
moxie,
a lot of intestinal fortitude.
Well, that's what Giorgio wants, is to be, not to be around the wimpy people. She wants to be around the strong people, make it worth it, you know?
Well, she's trying to bait him too.
Yeah.
And it's just not working. And with her, again, oh my God, such skill that she has. Whenever she has her back turned and is just facing us on camera, but it's not anybody else. Like you said, Pat, you can see the worry in her eye. Mm-hmm. You can see it go across it. She does this disdained look at him. And then when she turns around, you see what's really playing in her face.
Yeah.
So that was good.
And I think he really got to her when he said, you're scared, mm-hmm. Like she had to stop what she was doing. And she just like sat there for a second before she started insulting him again.
Right. She's like, you're the hero of the mess hall, you think.
Oh, and I love that one quote from the doctor where he's like, since you don't want to cooperate, you can determine if the root is physiological, psychological, temporal, or interdimensional on your own. It's like, oh, that's so awesome. Love that one.
Yeah, well, that's what you've got to do. It's like, look, I know what I'm doing here. Would you fucking pay attention?
Yeah. Yeah. And she doesn't, for somebody who's a control freak, not having no control of what's happening to you is frightening. Mm-hmm. It's very frightening. So that was a good opener.
Then we switch over to the bridge and Osira shows up.
No, that's the next section.
No, it's not.
Yeah, next section. So this one was Osira gave her nephew to the trans. transform, and the transform was like, I'm gonna eat you, and the nephew's like, no, but I'm so tranced. Okay, you can eat
me. So tasty.
And all my time of owning little reptiles and animals, is the first time I saw a mealworm get a meal.
Would you ever feed one of your family members to, to the local bug like that? What's up with that?
Don't give away trade secrets.
She was done with him. He's like, please, auntie, don't, please. She's like, they will put you in a trance while they eat you. That's why they call it trance worms.
She's like, don't be childish. Just get eaten already.
You're not going to feel a thing.
And just a little trivia on who Osyra is. She is played by Janet Kidder, who is the niece of Margot Kidder from Superman. And you might recognize her from such shows as Man in the High Castle, Arrow, X-Files, Continuum, and Earth Final Conflict.
That's why she looks so familiar.
Yeah, that's why she can hold her own right there on the screen. Mm-hmm, she's good at it.
She's got chops, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and so did her nephew. He got chopped.
He got chopped really into several pieces.
And that was so funny where she's like, I had complicated feelings about your father, and you're so much like him. Die.
Goodbye.
Yeah, like, jeez.
You should have run when she said that. Like, oops, okay, bye.
Yep.
And it goes like, you believe me, don't you? Yeah, that wasn't a good thing.
Well, she said, they'll put you in a trance and you won't feel a thing. But then he was screaming.
Well, you
obviously
know,
he felt something.
He was just screaming because it was terrifying. He wasn't screaming because he was being eaten.
Was he screaming while he was being eaten?
Well, yes. I mean, he probably once he got chomped, yeah.
For a little bit. You can say that once the trance worm got to him, he went to pieces.
His leg flew off.
He fell apart.
Yeah, he fell apart with the pressure. That's for certain.
I'm so glad that trance worm didn't do the same thing to Michael and he spit her out instead.
Yeah, because it was full already.
Right. That's right. That makes sense.
So, but it was definitely interesting.
Yeah, it had eaten a couple people already.
You know, it's like, I possibly can't have another human. I'm full.
Yeah, too much.
But this is still the same section where Michael is talking to Book.
Yeah, Book needs to go home. That's the little scene right there was like, I gotta go home. Yeah.
So they had to get permission from the Admiral.
Which, I know that part is probably the next section. But you see, again, how the characters are developing a relationship. Little body language things, like a touch here, a look, a hand hold. So that was pretty good. Okay, I think we can go to the next section because I'm excited about that section too.
I, Captain. Act 1, Homebound. Saru and Number One are having their daily meeting as they walk down the halls of Discovery. One of their important tasks is to figure out a good catchphrase, like hit it, execute, or manifest. Captain Freeman had the same problem on the Cerritos. They stop by the science lab and Stamets and Nadira have figured out the origin of the burn. When messing with the different audio frequencies, they find their favorite 3189 lullaby, as well as a Federation ship SOS beacon. Afterwards, Adira discusses pronoun preferences with Stamets. Discovery jumps to Book's home planet, however the captain's new catchphrase fizzles spectacularly. The doctor scans the human sperm, also called Giorgio. Gray is ghosting Adira. Michael and Book visit the sanctuary and find a gorgeous, vibrant blue sea locust, as well as Book's brother, who is armed to the teeth and ready to take them down.
This had a lot of emotional resonance in this one. You had a chance also to see the way that Tilly has taken her job seriously, is because when Ren comes into the room and he's like, you know, which one are you, the captain? And she's like, oh, no, you didn't.
No, you didn't.
You will speak with the respect he's deserved. It's like, go ahead, Tilly. She's just like, right there.
Go, girl. Yeah.
Step. She's like, I will own you. So that was good to see. That was really nice to see with that interplay between them. And they actually did the right thing this time. They got permission.
Oh, yeah. With the Admiral.
Permission? What's that?
They got permission. So the Saru, as well as Michael, learned their lesson.
Well, I mean, learned it for half an episode.
Well, for the moment, anyway.
Right? And it's really, it was interesting too to see Giorgio as a doctor's patient actually being put under and everything.
That was the best part.
Oh, that was so funny. She starts insulting him.
You're going to come backward, okay? I was like, what you need is the, and then she's gone.
And they're like, we love advancement.
So there has been some wonderful advancements in the world of medical technology.
We can get unruly patients to shut up quickly.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I don't understand why a doctor doesn't just run around with a phaser and set the stun and just stun people and just do it that way. You know, in the world of Star Trek, why isn't that feasible? But no, they got to just like, you know, give them the medical dose and she gone.
And Giorgio is like, there are so many jokes to be had here. If you're going to torture me, at least let me have a little fun.
Yeah, that was cute.
That was. And then the flashbacks and everything. So Giorgio is yelling San, S-A-N, and not Sun, S-O-N. So I thought it was S-O-N. It was actually S-A-N, and that's a name. This is referring to that it's same San that we see in the book Star Trek Discovery Die Standing by John Jackson Miller, which was released in July 2020.
And it's, that book also gives us some background information, some possible, you know, theories on what's happening with Giorgio. So remember Kovich, the guy with the big glasses from a couple episodes back?
Uh-huh.
The old guy?
Remember the one guy wearing glasses in the whole show?
Yeah. Right. Okay.
Oh, so, yeah. He's like the only one, right?
Yeah. Well, because you don't need glasses in the 31st century. I mean, hello.
But they just make it look so much more sophisticated.
It's like wearing earrings or a necklace. It's an accessory.
Right. So there's two theories. One is that he is going to give her a conscience.
What?
Somehow or another.
What? Yeah. I don't know about that.
How do you give someone a conscience?
They found a way to tap into a pivot point in her past where she turned cold and allow her to make a more connection just beyond Michael Burnham. So what they think is that Giorgio believes that Michael Burnham was possibly responsible for the death of San. So if they can change her conscience, they can sever her loyalty to Michael Prime and make her more amenable to recruitment, possibly to Section 31. And then the second theory is that Giorgio is being used to access the mirror universe.
Mm.
So, and all of this, it's all anchored in the specific theory of San, but it remains to be seen what that is. But the graphics, when her face went all twitchy, like, whoa, what's going on here?
That was the medical scan, right? Going crazy. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was really interesting.
It really was. You're looking at her and it's like, oh my God, she's like literally, they were joking about deconstruction, but is she really deconstructing?
No, that's just the scan was deconstructing. But
it is like, wow. So yeah. that was definitely bizarre that happened with that. Then you get a chance to see Michael and Book on their home world, on Book's home world, at least, and know that he had a different name. Yeah, and he had a different name, and he went by a different name.
What was it, Terelix or?
I'm not going to even attempt to pronounce it, and Heather, don't you dare.
It looks like a bad typo.
it was a bad day. So get down on the planet. Imagine going to your old neighborhood, and all of a sudden you're surrounded by everyone wanting to shoot you.
Bad neighborhood.
Well, isn't that what happens when you go home?
Yeah, that always will happen in my old home, my very first old home. Yeah, that would not be a good idea.
Yeah. Can we talk about Book's brother, Kaim?
Sure.
Uh-oh.
Damn, Daddy.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, is that what we were going to talk about?
Damn, Daddy. He is hot. I'm liking me some Qui-Gon meat.
But I thought it was the accent. I thought that the little flavor in there was what did it. But,
no,
but
if you look him up on IMDb, like, he's got all these picture modeling pictures and stuff without the beard. Like he was like, I mean, damn.
Okay. Cause I was going to say, cause he has a baby face, but the beard, the goatee, it just doesn't go with the baby face.
Look him up on IMDb and you'll see. So, I mean, there's like, wow.
Oh my God. I know he has to be hot. Cause this is the first time Patrick is actually tongue tied.
So wow. Anyway, see, got my Kaim crush going on.
What happened if HR looks like him?
Oh,
well, maybe then.
Oh,
you didn't even find out what they look like. But yeah, he went down to the planet and he was surrounded. And it was like, wow, what's going on here? And you can see that she's trying to put things together. So like, what's going on? Why do they don't like you, Book? So it was pretty cool. How about you, Rocky? What'd you think about this section?
Well, yeah, there's a big mystery to it because you know, one time you get to go back, you finally find somebody you think you're gelling with, and you go back and you meet their family, or or, you know, at least back to their home planet and go, wow, they don't like them so much here. What's going on? And why are they trying to kill us all of a sudden? What did I get into?
Well, then you find out why he's actually, you know, why the brother messaged him to come back to the planet. So,
well, yeah. And then the those locusts, sea locust things that don't have much to do with actual sea, but they definitely float around. That's for sure.
Really pretty.
They were very cool looking. One of the ready rooms back, they did an interview with one of the 3D animation guys that designed that. And that was just a lot of fun to watch and then see them actually in full. Because I think we saw a hint of one of them before, but this was like a whole bunch of them. It was neat to see them. And I guess they're not very helpful for the whole famine thing going on in the planet.
Also had a chance to see that how Book became a courier is that it looks like that his people there on that planet are really good when it comes to tracking and woodscraft, because Michael had no idea that they were surrounded and Book felt it right off the bat. He's like, put your hands up. She's like, what? Because put your hands up.
Well, he does have that little empathic thing going on. She does call them empaths.
Right. And so doesn't that mean you can like feel the other people? You don't have to see them, but you feel them.
He kind of, you know, had a total like, oh,
someone's behind that tree. Yeah.
Not enough to know that we should turn around and go the other way, but just enough to know, oh, shit, we're in trouble.
Right.
Yeah. Definitely. They were all there. And then you get Osiris's ship shows up and it's a big humping ship.
I mean, arm to the teeth.
Yeah. It's a big, big ship, and it appears there. And then she, like, Saru, give him credit, is being as diplomatic as the Admiral told him. It's just like, I don't understand why you want this guy. Why do you want him?
I think that's the next section. Yeah.
Well, I mean, they definitely see, they warp in and they're not shielding anything. It's like, she's letting it all hang out. I mean,
that's the,
like,
next section.
Are we sure?
The next section.
Yeah. So before we go on to the next section, I want to talk about one thing. So they were talking about catchphrases at the beginning of this.
Oh, God.
And I thought that was funny. Like, is this a normal conversation for captains to have with their, like, number ones? Because this is, like, the second time we've seen it this year.
It was so awkward.
It's kind of like, well, come on. What are you going to say? You haven't said it yet. What are you going to say?
Execute.
What would your catchphrase be?
Beat it, bitch.
Beat it.
Beat it. It comes with a little dance too.
Oh, I was thinking he'd make a hand motion when he said that.
Oh. Beat it. Yeah.
I was thinking, let's do this thing. Let's roll. Let's rock.
Go.
And then I like a rocket, you know, like pun intended. And then I was thinking, just do it. But the USS Nike took that one.
Nike,
so.
Yeah. You can't just do it because Nike's owned it. They own that. Yeah.
Yeah. USS
or you could just
Nike
say,
that.
You could just say, do it.
Do it.
Do it all night.
Well, okay. Before we move on to the next section, I found it really interesting that the song playing in the Verubian Nebula was the same one that the Barzan mother was singing, the same one that Gray played, the same one that Adira now knows how to play.
It's weird, scientifically speaking.
Right? First and foremost, it's weird, scientifically speaking, but it's this thread throughout the season so far. It's this song.
I got upset because they didn't focus on it. That's all they gave us for this whole episode. And I was upset because I'm like, you should focus the whole episode on that.
Yeah, there's like, I mean, yes, scientifically speaking, I agree with you. This is a kind of a big deal. No matter about the whole, you know, emerald chain of destruction going on. What's going on with this tune on coming in on the radio? What's that song? We need to find out what that song is.
Everybody in this century knows in one form or another.
Yeah, that's a big deal.
It's got to be something, I think, dealing with the temporal or quantum, because it's harmonizing all the way across. So it'd be curious if that's going to tie in the Giorgio some way too. It's almost like a carrier signal that's going out for everybody to know and understand and to feel it. But I would be remiss if we left this section without talking about a most impactful and pivotal part is when Indira announced that they were they.
Yes.
Yeah.
The look on Stamets' face when Adira says, I prefer they or them, I never felt like a she. The look of pride on his face, I was in tears. Aww. I mean, it was such a huge moment, you know, for Adira to come into their own. And Stamets was just like, he kind of had the look on his face was kind of like, okay, I already knew this, but I'm so happy that you're finally, you know, that you feel comfortable enough to tell me.
Yeah.
It was very, you know, again, Star Trek is breaking ground, having a non-binary person with pronouns of they and them.
Yeah.
And if you watch the after show, that episode actually mirrored when the actor came out to their parents as well, and how they felt that Stamets and Colbert, the people who portrayed them, is like their on-set dads, that they're just as protective, just as loving, just as... So that was a really, really nice moment. And you could see the turmoil on their face when they decided to address it. It was like going out on a limb. Look, I need to tell you, I don't feel comfortable being a she, and I much prefer if you call me they or them. And it took some guts to say it, because everybody's scared of rejection. So that was pretty good.
Yeah.
It got me right in the feels. Faux show.
Which feels?
I'm not going to go.
That's very specific, sir. I don't think you're allowed to ask that question. HR.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Keep it above board. Keep it above board.
Well, you don't keep things above your board. So that's why I was just asking. But that was a really touching moment. And that was really good character development. And I loved how Stamets has grown. Basically, he's still curmudgeon-y. He's still, you know, attitude wise, but there's a lot of tenderness there now. And I'm enjoying seeing that.
Well, later when him and Adira are playing music together, that's, you know.
It's a lot of tenderness. So I enjoy that part.
Yeah. I like that they can jam together playing music. I thought that was beautiful and nice that we saw that. You guys didn't talk about Linus and his shedding yet.
Oh, that's right. Thank you.
I just had to bring that up because that was hilarious. Linus is shedding.
No, he was committed to quarters. He's confined to quarters while he was shedding.
That's some serious shedding. That's pretty gross.
Well, when you're shedding in a mess hall, come on.
Can you imagine you're having your meatball and spaghetti?
It gets everywhere, right?
It's like, oh my God, is that Linus skin?
Oh, oh man, food. That ruined your whole lunch.
It's like, ew.
Well, I mean, it's better than a triple fur.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, they shed a lot.
You know, but you know what my first thought was when they say they can find him? Is that he's been doing what we talked about. He's been popping up with the transporter and shouting.
No, it wasn't that. It was actually the shedding.
I know. It's like, oh my God, I bet you he's going into showers and things like
what
that.
What if that's a code word for shedding? I mean, what if that's a code word for him popping in and out? Oh, Linus was shedding again, quote unquote.
Seriously. So my first thought when they said that, it's like, oh my God, he's being a dirty birdie. But that was pretty cool. Okay, now I think we're done with this section. Sorry.
He probably popped in somewhere and left some skin after and turned around happened. And that's how I got found out. Yeah.
Is this lizard skin in my underwear drawer?
Ew. Oh my God, how'd that get in there?
I'm rewashing all my underwear.
Whose skin is in my underwear drawer? It's like it puts the lotion on its skin or it gets the hose again.
Oh, God.
I think we lost the captain.
No, I'm still here.
Okay.
I was waiting for Heather to continue.
You were just dead quiet. I was like, what's going on?
No, I'm just listening to the train wreck and glad that HR is not listening to us directly.
Quietly thinking, go Heather. Next section, go Heather, yes, go Heather. Please.
Okay. Act two, demands made. So Giorgio is having a seriously bad reaction to the sperm scan. And Book brings Michael home to meet the family. Osira does a holozoom meeting with Saru and the bridge crew and demands the Andorian Ryan. She gives him 5 minutes and then calls Book's bro. She demands that he give her Book and Michael or else she'll burn the planet to the ground.
This was great because when Georgia's aunt getting, you know, examined and they're almost done with the atomic scan and she's like freaking out and she busts up and he's like, can you tell us what you were feeling? She's like, I was having a beautiful dream about your head mounted on my wall.
Not helpful, Georgia. Yeah. Not helpful.
Like, yeah, well, how are we going to know what's going on with you if all you're dreaming about is my head on your wall? I mean, you know.
So in the future, are doctors psychologists too? No, they're not because Deanna Troi, right? So it's still separated.
But Hugh does have background training.
I think it's like anything else in medical. I mean, you have people that specialize in things, but you also have a general knowledge of a lot.
Yeah.
So you can kind of have your expertises in several areas. And on a starship, that's quite useful.
Do you guys know what the doctor's expertise is?
I don't think they ever mentioned it.
Oh my God. Jesus Christ, dude. Come on.
What was that?
That was inappropriate.
Wait, that was Heather, I think.
Is it?
Oh, gosh, it was Heather.
He does it way better.
See, I was like, oh, my God. Okay, we're really going off the rails again here. But, yeah, we'll eventually find out what his expertise is. But, yeah, she was definitely cracking on the thing. She wants to know how to fix herself, and she's just not equipped to fix herself. Mm. That's why she stole that thing when she got up. And you watch the scene. You see her palm the device that was on her that was taking her reading.
Yeah, and I was like, I watched this a few times and I kept looking and I didn't see her steal it. Like, the doctor took both of them and had both of them in his hands. So how did she get that? I didn't see her steal it. There was more than one on there, I guess.
That's the only reasoning I have, because it's not like AirPods. There's only two of them. No, I think there's another one they stick on somewhere else.
When you're the Empress of the Terran universe, you learn how to palm item that you
want. Yeah, if you ever see Giorgio in the hallway, make sure you got your wallet on the way out.
Right. Okay, red flag. If Giorgio bumps into me, I just got screwed.
Yeah, more ways than one.
You feel lucky.
I mean, the least she could do is, like, you know, let me enjoy it.
Give you a hand.
Now, in this one, when Osiris talking to Saru, they're mocking each other's history as far as slavery goes. So Saru had the history of Kelpians being enslaved, and then he counters to Osiris. If memory serves correctly, the Orions were once enslaved themselves.
Yeah, that was a lot of catfighting that.
Right. So. But here's the thing. So Saru's not technically right. I mean, he is right from his point of view, but in the original series era, they assumed that the Orion women were slaves. But then later on, we find out that the Orion women are actually, they're in control of the Orion crime syndicate. They're the ones in control and they're using the illusion of slavery. And we find that out in Enterprise episode Bound.
That is correct.
So Saru was right, but he was, like, also wrong. And then that's why Osiris said, my ancestors knew that power is virtue and that there is no nobility in suffering. Like, she's referring to this, you know, faux appearance that women were enslaved, when in fact they were, you know, the ones running the government.
The image that those Orion women used to have about being these belly dancers and being endeared, she just, like, they totally threw it out the window. She's like, I'm a badass and I'm going to show you just how the badass I am. And she's calculating. She's makes decisions binary wise. If you don't give me this, then this is going to happen. You know, I want this. And if I don't get it, this is going to happen. So now we know where the guy in the very first step, or the second episode, we saw who he was really scared of. It was probably Osiris.
Oh, yeah. Osiris, like, you want to escalate, motherfucker? Okay, we can escalate. You want to go further than that? I got three more steps we can go. Oh, yeah, I got another one you can go too. You want to mess with me? Come here, mess with me. I can take care of you. She's not fucking around.
No, like, let me be described. If you don't give me book, I'm going to cut off your food. And you have children? Have you ever seen a child starve? It's not pretty. And I'm going to starve your children. You know, that's dude.
Yeah.
That's she's vicious. Really mean. I mean, come on. How can you think of starving a child? And it's just like you said, what's the temperature out? Oh, it's going to be 72 today. It's like, that's she's definitely an evil person.
That's a sociopath right there.
That's why Kaim was, you know, intent on getting book to her, because he knew, you know, that she has no conscience and she'll do whatever she wants.
She's probably a psychopath, because sociopaths, they actually get angry, but psychopaths don't get angry. And she didn't seem to get angry.
No, she didn't.
No, she was just running her regular scheme. I mean, she is dominating everywhere and she doesn't want to make it painful, but people are making it painful. So she'll make it painful. If you want it painful, I'll give you some pain.
She'd be good in a dungeon.
Yeah, it's like, oh my God, you pissed me off, so I'm cutting your antennas off. Wow. You see they're beginning to grow
just
back.
Just hand her a whip and some handcuffs and you can charge by the hour.
I mean, you saw how she dealt with family. She fed him to the fucking transworms. So this woman is not to be trifled with.
No.
She reminds me of a woman that I heard of that was on.
Once in a lullaby?
No, that was on Craigslist. She's a dominatrix. And what she does is that she charges men to come to her house and clean it for her. So they come to her
house. They pay to clean her house.
Yeah. Yes. And she orders them and tortures them and everything to clean her house.
Whatever works for you.
Well,
I was always wondering why Heather's place looks so clean.
Yep, because you know I don't do it myself.
Wasn't going to say names.
Everyone's going to start going on Craigslist for that ad and try to, and it's not actually going to be Heather. They're going to find someone, the actual person. It's like,
I go by a different name on there.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, well, everybody's got a different name on Craigslist.
When they were on planet, you saw the family dynamics and you get a chance to see more of a history on what's going on between Book and his brother.
I was just going to say that the family theme is running throughout this episode. Again, you've got Book and his brother, Kaim. You've got Adira and Stamets, who have are becoming family. You've got Michael and Giorgio. I mean, it's a theme throughout the show.
It really is. And to see the whole situation of attitude going back and forth, there was some real anger between the brothers.
Yeah, and family does that.
Yeah. Kaim thinks Book abandoned them, you know, so for 15 years.
Yeah, that's kind of a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. But it shows he also values Book and demands that he thinks that a lot of their problems wouldn't have been if Book didn't leave.
Yeah, if you don't care about someone, he wouldn't have been so mad.
Yeah, yeah. This is a thin line between love and hate. So what was your favorite part in this section, Heather?
In this section in particular?
Uh-huh.
Let's see.
Did you have a favorite section?
Probably the sperm scan. I think that was my favorite.
Because we all know Heather just likes her some sperm.
I thought that outfit was so funny.
She looked wrapped up like a present. You just throw a bow on her and you could serve her for Christmas.
But it wasn't just, it's like, you know, those holographic like stickers where you move them and they change color. It's like they put that a leotard and they're like, okay, it's the futuristic, you know, medical gown. And I'm like, what?
Yeah, but I bet it looks really fantastic in person. I mean, the level of costume design on this show is so high. I mean, yes, it stands out. It does stand out. I bet it looks really fucking cool in person.
Yeah.
You imagine you're sitting in your living room and your significant other walks in with that and you look at him and goes, oh.
See? Thank you. You know exactly what I was talking about. That's not medical gown like appropriate.
Yeah, medical technology has advanced 900 years.
Right? Like that's something you go and you party in or, you know, something else.
Ready to take a night on the town. No, I'm just getting the scan.
You're going out clubbing, you know, some techno-industrial music. Bah, 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 bah,
right?
Bah,
all she needed was some accessories and she was like set.
Some glow sticks and, you know, a couple drops of ecstasy.
If I had to wear something like that all the time, I would be living in the holodeck running the gym program.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm running the same program, but they're all naked. It's the nude male Olympic program.
Using the Mariner special.
I am.
You were asking favorite parts. I just wanted to say the way Osira was. He's like, oh, it's been a while since we've seen Starfleet. Are you lost? I just love her attitude.
That was a real slide.
Because we're wondering, who the hell is Osira? What, I mean, they built up a lot. So who the fuck is Osira? And like, oh, that's who she is. Oh, watch out for her. She's a little dangerous. Yes. And what's Starfleet done? What is the Federation? Because she even used the hubris word when she talked about the Federation. So something's, you know, it's not hunky-dory Starfleet land going on in this world.
No. And the guy's name again, the Andorian.
Rin.
When Rin got on there, he gives an indication about it. They didn't pick it up, but you saw that Saru had counteracted what he had said. Was like, what do you want? Starfleet never does something without asking for something in return.
Yeah, the Starfleet is not as happy and fun as we remember.
No, and if something's going on there, Starfleet is like going around collecting favors. You know, if we do this for you, then you got to do something for us.
It also shows that they're hiding something, you know, because they're not showing Saru the face that they're hearing everyone talk about, you know.
Yeah, there's definitely something going on.
Yeah, this is bubbling up in the background, and I think it's going to boil over this season.
Well, I think once the burn happened, I mean, it's kind of like every man for themselves at that point, because then, you know, after the burn, the Federation fell apart. So you kind of have to do favors for people and, you know, gain favors in this post-burn world.
But they had 100 years to prove themselves. And in 100 years, everyone's like, don't trust them.
Yeah. Yeah. Some people remember the ideas of old and other people are like, we don't say, even in the first episode, don't say you're from the Federation.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, like he said, we were kids. They said we'd send our way to Federation camp. This is, boy, that's not a thing. That's the next section. Sorry about that. Sorry, Heather.
Do you want to go on to the next section?
Yeah.
Okay. Act three, power struggle. Discovery is stuck between a rock and a hard place when Osiris starts firebombing the planet. Luckily, Detmer is willing to take one for the team and go rogue. She, quote, borrows Book's ship and the Andorian, and they attack Osiris' ship, specifically her weapon system. On the planet, Book and Michael are fighting Kaheem's game, which ends up in a game of chicken between Book and his brother. Will Kaheem turn Book in?
This section here, to me, was kind of like Dempner's redemption.
Oh, this is awesome.
Yeah.
Because you see that she's still freaked out about everything. You see, she's still upset about everything. But when she got on Book's ship, it eventually just all went away.
Full manual control. She kicked ass. I was giddy like a schoolgirl in this. Like, it's like, oh yeah, she's flying. The shots are cool. Shots are awesome. And then they threw in for comic effect. Grudgy comes in and attacks Rin.
What is this? What that sound it's making?
Oh my God. If that was any normal cat, that cat would be freaking going crazy. How did that cat stay so calm during a space fight?
It's so funny. You get a domesticated cat and you invite somebody into your house for the first time and they're just sitting down. You're just shooting the shit, talking, whatever. And your cat just like, oh, there's a lap over here. I'm going to sit down and say hi and be an affectionate. And that freaks the person out because they're not expecting this. They've never had a cat in their lap in their life. It's so funny to see that happen to, big tough guys. I've seen it happen to, like, oh my God, what the hell is this? We've seen mail delivery people freak out because a cat's sitting on our porch. I'm like, it's just a cat sitting on the porch. But they're like, oh my God, it's a friggin' dragon. I'm not delivering your mail today. I'm like, well, it's so funny to see that kind of reaction, and the Andorian has it.
there's a bunch of shorts on Netflix called Love and Robots. And they have one where the world is supposedly gone and it just these robots and they come across cat. And when it's petting the cat, it starts to purr. And it goes, what is that noise? It's making, I think if you stop it, it'll explode. Don't stop. keep petting it.
That's awesome.
It's really kind of funny. But this section also gives a chance to see why Osira wants Rin back so badly. He knows things.
Because he's got a secret. The Emerald Chain is short on dilithium, people. That's
he knows things. But not only that part as being a secret, he knew how to hurt her ship with a little tiny ship. I mean, her ship was huge.
Once he figured out how to handle the cat, he's like, oh, go target that over there. Detmer's tearing the fuck out of the ship. It's like, oh no, you just need to hit right over there. Like, and then that completely disables it.
Well, when you've been on a slave planet, you know, mining old destroyed ships and then a giant pussy jumps in your face. I mean, you know,
it's intimidating.
It's a little scary.
It's distracting.
Yeah.
You know, but when she finally did that, this is like in my academy days and she did manual control. It freed something in her. You can see that whatever angst that she was going through was kind of solved. It's like, I'm not alive until my shields are down to 10% and we get a chance to die.
And she's got to have hands on. I love that about Detmer. She is a hands on kind of gal.
Yeah, she even redid the configuration.
She's got to get a feel for it. Yeah, she's got to get her hands on it. Once she gets hands on it, she's got total control of it. And she's going to, you know, do the job and do it right. And
her self-doubt is now gone.
Yeah.
So
it's funny, you know, we have so many wonderful interfaces, even today with our touch screens. It's wonderful what you can do with these many cool little interfaces. And you click and dot and things and you can swipe left and right and double tap, triple tap and quadruple tap. I mean, it's amazing what we can do with technology. But sometimes you just want to grab the joystick and hit the fire button. And I love the simplicity of that.
I usually do that when I'm alone.
That's okay, buddy. You and your fire button. I love that Detmer has kind of got that. And, you know, the person, of course, that directed the episode, Mr. Frakes, was also the hands-on kind of guy in that one movie where he grabbed the joystick and had manual control. I love that that has come through. Yeah.
That was Star Trek Insurrection.
Insurrection,
so it was on
yeah.
Enterprise. And Riker flew the Enterprise just like Detmer did, where he had the joysticks and everything.
I mean, it's funny when you look at the dynamics of space. space and space combat and compare it to aerial combat and try to represent it and make it look cool visually as an effect and be realistic. No, it's probably not that realistic, but it looks really cool and it's a lot of fun. And I love just the grab the hands on kind of control.
And you know that she doesn't suffer from motion sickness.
No, not at all.
A person flying and flipping and twisting like that, they would lose it. They would lose their lunch easily.
I'm surprised Rin didn't throw up on Grudge.
Or yeah. Grudge didn't throw up.
Well, Grudge probably is used to it.
Grudge probably throws up all the time. There's probably all kinds of hairballs on that ship. It's just part of the interface.
I hope they don't do that, because if they did, I probably would laugh so hard I'd have to be taken to the hospital. If they're going to sit there and they're going through this big thing and all of a sudden in the background, yeah.
The cat gets a hairball in the middle of combat. You want to freak Rin out really badly. Oh, man.
It's horrible when cats get hairballs. I literally, mine have woken me up in the middle of the night. They'll be sitting on the edge of the bed going, bah, 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 bah. Oh, and it wakes me up.
And the worst thing is stepping in it accidentally when it's fresh. Oh man, why do they always do it right in the walkway?
Because they want you to step in it.
Anyway,
that's where they are.
That's what cats do.
Yeah.
But the thing also, we have a chance to see that Saru has gotten a little bit of Giorgio in him, because he wanted to follow Starfleet's rule. Normally, Saru is like a stickler. If they say do this, we do this. But he's like, yeah, but what if we had a pilot that didn't obey orders? And
well, that was Tilly's idea. That was great. Yeah. I love how they just like, hey, how about this solution? And they're like, yeah, that's a good solution. Then Detmer turns around and goes, aha. Just kind of like, it's a perfect solution for the time. Yeah.
Yeah, but he went with it.
Yeah. Now he's knowing to stretch and how to stretch, when to stretch. And, exactly. You know, he bend those rules to his will.
But he opened the library on Osiris. He's like, oh, it seems like your ship is damaged. May we assist?
Oh, that was so funny.
That was probably the most rude thing he could have said to her.
Right. Oh, my God. That was such like the smirk on his face when he said that.
And it pissed her off.
Total shade, man. You will feel the full weight of the chain.
Which is her way of saying, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you. And she rage quit.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
You know, that's like in a video game when you beat somebody so bad, they just rage quit. They don't even say good game or anything. They just disconnect.
I haven't done that in a while. That was fun.
You know.
Online play.
Yeah. So I thought that was pretty cool. And then you get to the explosions and things are happening. I mean, come on. You carpet bombing an entire planet because you didn't get your way?
Yeah.
Hey, she likes to escalate. Let me speak to a manager. Oh, you are the manager. Oh, okay, you can't do this for me? Yeah. She's a space Karen. Totally.
An Orion Karen.
Seriously.
But that's how she became in charge, because she just kept asking for the manager and she's just like, I don't have patience for this. I'm gonna blow your ass away.
She asked for the manager and she killed him and then asked for the next manager.
Well, that's the way Darth Vader would do it. I mean, he just kind of, you know, oh, you're running things the wrong way, okay, you're done. Pinch the fingers, you're starting to choke all of a sudden.
Now don't you disappoint me, Admiral Piet. So definitely I was like, wow. She knows that there's children, there's people down on the planet. And she's like, I don't give a shit. You give me what I want or I'm going to wipe you out and starve you. Like, wow, that was vicious.
Well, it works for her. It's a horrible method and it works for her.
Yeah, no mercy whatsoever. She's not exactly mercy. Any woman is going to kill her own blood, you know.
In her world, she is the nice guy.
Yeah, really. It's like, I gave you a choice. What more do you want?
Like, I'm being reasonable with you.
I mean, seriously, I see either.
Do what I want or else.
It's like, either you want me to kill you by knife or by the gun. I'm giving you a choice. I mean, come on.
And look, and if you're not going to do that, okay, fine. Your kid's going to starve too, okay? Come on. Work with me here. Mm-hmm. It's just like, Jesus Christ, woman. You're crazy.
You're crazy.
And then we see the Battle Royale. Wait, we didn't get to that section yet because Heather didn't mention in her clip.
Should we do that?
Are we missing anything?
Execute.
Else? Oh, that was funny. That was earlier. When you said that, everyone looks at each other and goes, yeah, that didn't work.
Yeah, it fizzled.
It was very uncomfortable.
Okay, next section.
Okay, Act 4.
Heather, execute.
Act 4, victory. Kaheem is unable to turn his brother in, and the fighting stops. However, the space fight between Detmir and Osyra is still going strong as Detmir disables her weapon system, sending her running. Just before warping out, Osyra gives Starfleet a message. They are royally fucked. Kaheem is screwed as well if they can't solve this sea locust problem. Luckily, Burnham has the bright idea to amplify their prayers around the world, and it worked. The sea locusts move back to the sea, and the crops are saved. Book has such a good experience that he starts to think about joining Starfleet. That's afterwards with his pussy. During their mini mess hall celebration, Ren tells Tilly that the reason why Osyra wanted Ren so badly was because he knows the Emerald Chain is running out of dilithium and is getting desperate.
And apparently this is like a bigger secret that's going on. And it was good to see Mary sitting there with her husband when they were playing off of one another. That was a cute scene there when she's trying to figure him out and vice versa. And that was towards the tail end.
Vice versa.
Exactly. But that fight was really cool. And then we have the brothers making up, basically. After that, the look that Michael has said, "Don't you beat my man, I will shoot you in the head."
Later on, when they're on the ship, I thought they were going to travel with Starfleet, with Discovery. And then I found out later, after watching it like 15 million times, no, they're staying on the planet. They were just, you know, visiting.
Yeah, you get a tour, you know, convenient tour. If we save your world, you get a complimentary tour out of it.
Yeah. The weather started.
And if you're lucky, you get a piece of Linus.
I'd rather have a piece of Kaheem.
No, that was funny. It's like, do you want to go peel his skin off?
That was so funny. It was like, hey, you know what you want to do, kiddo? Peel a piece of his face off. This is awesome.
Let's go peel his skin off. I used to have a person in the Marines used to get so upset because they'd go out to the beach and they get sunburned and they start peeling. And I would say, let me peel one off.
Oh, man. So some people are like, oh, can you help me get this? I'm like, that's really gross.
You're peeling like a snake.
Yep. And they peel off massive sheets of it at once. They try to get the biggest piece possible. It's just like, oh my God.
Well, of course.
You know, if you give snake skin to kids, they're very happy for some reason.
Well, skin's cool. I mean, if it's not yours and you can just hang on to it, it's just like, you know, you got to buy the skin.
You can chew on it like jerky.
Oh, no.
I like a good jerky, though. I like a good jerky.
I like jerky, too, but not human skin jerky.
No skin jerky.
So. I'm just gonna not go there.
No jerky your skin?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm over here thinking, gross.
Jerky is. But that whole section really came down to, I mean, Osyra left pissed off. Saru knows he's going to have to explain this to the Admiral, but he can stand on principle because he didn't attack. He had a defensive posture, and it wasn't Federation ship that attacked. It was an independent. But it's just semantics because she still is going to blame the Federation, and she's still going to go after them no matter what.
Yeah.
Who's principal?
Well, his, Saru's, he stood
up. You said Saru was standing on principle. Who's principle?
Oh, no, that was a reach.
Ba-da-ba-ba.
That was a reach. But he basically kind of obeyed the letter of the spirit of the law, if not the letter.
Yeah, there you
but
go.
But the Admiral's going to be so pissed next episode.
I don't know. I wonder how pissed, because I think he's still playing his cards close. I think he's like, he's going to be pissed, but he's not going to show how pissed he is. He's just going to say, you know, you didn't do it the way I wanted you to do it. But you did it, so
they went against direct orders. I bet he's going to be pretty pissed.
Well, he told them, he didn't tell them not to attack. He said for them to maintain a defensive posture, and if Discovery is in danger of being caught, to get out of there. He never said don't attack. So in essence, Discovery didn't defend itself. It was Book's ship that did it.
Right, but Discovery should have jumped out of there as soon as Osyra's ship was there. So for them to stay,
but he couldn't because it was a crew member. He could use that as an excuse. I couldn't leave. I tried to broadcast for Michael to come on board, but we couldn't get through because they had defensive shields up.
Well, the way I look at it is the Discovery of the original era of Discovery, because we've got a lot of retrofits now. Discovery's not no slacking. They're not going to just let the ship go out there with the, you know, 1,000-year-old torpedo and phaser armory. They've modernized it. So yeah. The starship is not too shabby in far as defensive posture. news. So I wouldn't be worried about Discovery as much as I used to be before we jumped to the future like this. Yeah, beforehand, I'm like, oh shit, they're going to get their ass blown out like a tin can. But no, they're packing now. So Saru didn't open up that can of worms. He's played the defensive side still. So from his point of view, he's still playing it cool.
Yeah, he is. And it still went well. And plus, you know, the ship, like you said, Rocky's got new animation because we saw the nacelles had a new animation when it came in. They did something kind of funky when it made it to the planet after the black alert. So that was cool, too. And if you missed it, watch it again on that part. So that was interesting. But yeah, this whole thing when they get back, and you saw that anybody watched the preview for next week?
Oh, yeah.
I saw that. It's interesting. I watched it twice. I watch it once in the big room with the surround sound, and then I watch it again to take my notes. And on the second viewings, I always get the next week trailer. On the original viewing, I never see it. And I'm wondering if it's because I'm using different apps when I see it, or they're doing something different. Is the trailer out on Thursday night? I'm just tripping out on that because, yeah, I didn't see the trailer Thursday night, but I saw it this morning when I watched it.
Did you see the one from the Ready Room, though?
And the Ready Room's different. The Ready Room's got their own little snippet going on.
And that was a cool snippet.
I didn't see the one after. I saw the Ready Room, but I didn't see the one after, because when I watch it, when I watch Discovery, it's usually just after midnight, the first showing. And like you said, Rocky, there is no trailer.
Yeah.
So the only trailer that I see is when I watch the Ready Room the next day.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So there's actually a full on trailer after it. So I watch it on Apple TV the first night, and I do that because the surround sound seems to work correctly. Mm-hmm. On the second viewing, I just use the I've got a nice LG OLED TV, and it looks gorgeous on that. If you have the means, I highly recommend it. But on that, I'm just using the built-in app on the TV and the CBS Access app. And that one gives me the trailer. But the Apple TV one, when I watched it the first night, I don't get a trailer. It's very confusing. So there's an inconsistency they've got going on there. But there was a cool trailer, and next week looks like it's going to be very interesting, and we're going to find out some things about Giorgio.
Squee!
Yeah, yes. It does look like next one is going to be focusing on Giorgio, which I'm glad they're not going to stretch this out to like 3 seasons.
I know, right?
Oh, goodness. Yeah. The mystery.
God, I hope that would be really nice if they finished it by next episode, which, by the way, I was thinking the other day, Picard had 10 episodes. So how many episodes does Discovery have? So I checked it out and we have 13 episodes. So I was thinking like, oh, we got two more episodes left. No. We got like 5 more episodes. So we're good for a little bit.
Yeah, we got at least till Christmas, right?
I think so, yeah. Yeah.
It lays out nice on the calendar.
Well, that's good because we have there's a lot of breadcrumbs they left, a lot of stuff to unpack.
Yeah, I got to find out about this cool musical jam we got going on. We want to figure out what the remix of that's going to sound like.
Yeah, I'm really thinking it's got to have something to do with Quantum. It's got to be for everyone to have that song. It's definitely going to be interesting. And we got to see where Book and Michael's relationship is going, as well as Adira growing into their path on the ship. And what's going to happen? And the punishment is going to happen to Demner.
Yeah.
And then when Osira comes back, where's that going to go?
And she says she's going to attack everybody in the Federation.
She's going to make it hurt.
What is that going to force the Admiral to do?
Yeah. I really hope by then Giorgio's healed so she could go kick her ass.
That's, of course, they're going to be the big, you know, season finale episode when Giorgio gets to punish Osira. I can't wait for that. That's going to be awesome. And they have to do it. If they don't do it, it's like they've got to do it.
That would be awesome. That would be really, really cool. It'd be like everyone to gather around. Evil woman, fight!
When Giorgio and Michael were on the planet at the salvage yard talking to the nephew, there was a bit of foreshadowing where Giorgio said, sounds like my kind of woman. I'd like to meet her.
They'd probably just get along and go move off into the distance, you know, go take off into the sunset and never see them again.
That would be unexpected.
That would be
a good ending.
They just go rule the galaxy together.
They go get married. And have a bunch of little, you know,
and start Section 31
Orion babies.
That was a really good pickup there, Lieutenant Ferris.
Thank you.
Outstanding pickup. That's pretty friggin' cool. That would put a bow on it. That would be a nice little Christmas present. That was awesome. Okay, anybody else has anything on this section?
So Adira is grappling with being a Trill. I mean, I think they're still getting used to it because when they wake up in the morning, they don't know which one they're going to be. Are they going to be this one? Are they going to be that one? I remember in Deep Space Nine, Dax would always call back to, oh, so this person would do this. Or I feel like this person would do that because, oh, that, yeah, would totally do this because that's the kind of person that all the personalities inside your head at the same time. And are you going to be them or are you going to be your own personality because they all add together? It's a fascinating mind trip about who you're going to be and how you're going to be.
I think that's probably why no human has been a host for a simian before is because the Trills are either conditioned or just biologically more receptive to having those multiple, you know, voices in their head.
Literally multiple personality disorder, right. You can call it. Yeah.
Right. Whereas a human, it's like, you know, it's kind of overload. And she's like, I just don't know who I am.
But in the after show, the actor that plays Gray gave a little bit of a hint on where is Gray right now. And apparently Gray is trying to figure things out. And it'd be interesting how they're going to go down that storyline because Gray was young when it got the Trill. And then to have your life cut short like that, and now you're in your significant other's body, how do you deal with that? It's just like Bones had a hard time just dealing with Spock's Katra in his head. So
that's true.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting.
Well, that's because Bones was like, you know, those green-blooded hobgoblins.
It tricked me.
Yeah.
It's a mind meld.
So it's going to be interesting. They actually really left a lot of breadcrumbs and a lot of things to go through. The writing has been really good. But I do think we were talking over this morning over coffee, Heather, is that this did feel more like a, what did you call it? A what you call episode? Tastes great. Less
a filler episode.
There we go.
Yeah.
So it did kind of feel like that. It was like a transitional. They were like a foundational episode, a filler episode where they're setting things up to what they're going to expand.
A setup episode.
Set up those pins and knock them down.
Cool. Yeah. They have the whole season to play with and they're using the real estate of it to set it up and they got plenty of room to do it.
It was pretty good. And thank you for coffee this morning, Heather. That what did you call it? A English speaking muffin?
Oh. Yeah.
A McMuffin?
Was there cream in your coffee, Captain? Because, you know, with Heather and her spermatozoa soup.
No, Patrick.
Don't tell him what was in there.
Wait, what did you guys do?
There was all this talk about sperm this morning. I don't know.
The ground beans in there are just fine.
And I, all this time, and I thought there were clouds in my coffee.
Well, there were.
This is why Patrick shouldn't sleep in, because then I'm the one that has to get the captain's coffee.
Yeah, but this time you didn't mess up, so it was actually pretty good.
Or did she?
That's
even the clock is right twice a day.
I've been practicing.
A broken clock is right twice a day. Yeah.
This is true. Now, does anybody have... Wait, is there more left or did we finish this?
No, that's
we
it. Covered it.
We finished it? Is that it? Is that the end?
Tune in
that's
next week.
Yeah, same bad time, same bad channel.
We can find out more about what's going on with Giorgio and to see what the repercussions are going to be with the Admiral. It's going to be interesting. That's for certain. And we can see if we're going to get a guest or not next week. We got to do something and keep them from being scared to come to the ship. They still think that it's the old ship. We have a new hotness now.
Well, you know, if you would shower, that might help too.
Patrick, I hate to tell you this. You're smelling yourself.
Yeah, that it is you. It's not me.
I shower twice a day, so.
There's a reason I hang out in engineering all day.
Why do you think every time you come by, you think I'm singing the Police song because I like the song? I'm trying to warn you. Don't stand so close to me.
I just thought it was a caterwauling.
No. We're reached the end of the episode. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And for those of our special group that joins us on our premiere, you guys have become almost regular viewers. So this is a shout out to you, Dom. Woo-hoo. Thanks for always coming on board and listening to us on the premiere show. So it's greatly appreciated. If you have any questions, any show notes, anything you want to say, fan mail even, you can go ahead and reach us on social media. All of those will be on the tagline. You can find us. And please, the holidays is coming. Start your shopping now. They still have the thing there called Amazon, which is great. You don't have to go to the store. One click and your stuff is gift wrapped. So go ahead and get your Christmas shopping done early because the way the post office is, you don't want to get in there late. So thank you for joining us. Not only have a great and wonderful week, but make it so.
Starfleet Underground, beaming in to a podcast feed near you. Lock on to our website at StarfleetUnderground.com and send your comments and questions to thecollective@StarfleetUnderground.com. Follow us on Twitter @StarfleetUnderG and on Facebook and Instagram, we're Starfleet Underground.